Good morning. Praise the Lord. So I don't have anything supremely inspired, I guess, to share, but excuse me. On Friday, I had a meeting at work. I've been working with this group of people for the past 9 months on a special project that we were put on. And it's funny how you start finding out who's a Christian and all that. I remember in one of my marriage counseling sessions that my counselor told me that when two people are going through some sort of relationship struggle, they tend to get together because it's like they can smell each other. I think the same thing happens to us Christians. We can smell each other and we can find us. Not the same way though, because the devil tries to get in the way and block the smell, you know. But I started talking about this guy who's in my group, and we started talking about some scriptures and all that, and I think we spent longer talking about the word than we did talking in the meeting. And he told me, and this was really nice, he said, yeah, I talk about with the guy that's sitting next to me about the scriptures all the time. And he's like, I could talk about this all day without even noticing how much time has passed. So we're probably going to start getting together and talk about scriptures and all that. But then also Friday in the morning, I typically go somewhere downtown to get coffee before going to work. And the lady's starting to recognize me and know what I always order. So she's like, hey, Roberto. I said, hey, how are you? She said, good. She already had my order in the system. And she says, you know what? I'm so glad when you come in here. I said, really? She's like, yeah, because you're always smiling. So that kind of made my day. It was really nice of her of saying that and notice. And then when I was at home that day, someone posted something online about Psalm 27, and it was verse 13, and after I read it, for some reason I started crying. I'm like, okay. But I want to read you, that psalm right now, because after I read that specific verse, I went back and read the whole thing. And, you know, in the midst of everything that's going on, you know, after talking to my wife on Friday as well, I guess it was a very eventful day for me. It gave me this reassurance, I guess, that I might have been looking for and I didn't know that I need. So I want to read it to you. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing have I asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. And I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger, O you who have been my help. Cast me not off, forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out violence. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. I don't know if there was a specific reason as to why I was supposed to read that scripture on Friday. But if there is, it probably hasn't been revealed, or if it has, I'm probably not listening well enough. I know at some point I'm going to get it, but, you know, whatever it is you're going through, just keep remembering these words and remind yourself that no matter what happens, God is going to take care of us. Yes. We're only here on loan. And I was talking to my mom about this yesterday, and she said that she heard a pastor said that the reason why we get sick, we get hurt, and all that is because we were not born in this world. What was born was our spirit, which belongs in heaven. And that's why we go through all these things, because this is just a vessel in which we have to, our spirits have to be in order for us to be able to walk around and live. But it is our spirit that is actually what was born, and it's out of where it belongs. And that's why these things happen to us. So anyway, I love you all. Be blessed. And now I open the floor for questions. Anyone want to share a testimony, prayer request? Yes, James. Happy birthday, by the way. Anyone else? Pastor. Sheila.
Well, thank the Lord for my relatives being able to come and help that they were in, and we got to watch Wednesday service from home, so they enjoyed that, and just no bathroom, and she can't sit at 88 years old very long anymore. Thank the Lord for a good time. Just thank the Lord for his continued faithfulness to us. I got a call from this lady who wanted me to come and give her a bid, so I went and gave her a bid, and she's just telling me all this. She's raised Roman Catholic and turned to atheism and just called on the Lord and he gave her this thing. So I don't know where it's going to lead from here, but you know, the Lord really does direct our paths. And,
yes.
And he puts
yeah.
us where we need to be. And then
yes.
her last statement to me, she says, Sheila, you do a good job for me. I live in this facility here that has a lot of elderly people. I will share your name and you'll get so blessed that you won't even know what to do with yourself.
There it is.
That's good.
So,
yeah.
Sometimes we think that we're going to, you know, not be blessed or we're not going to, it's not going to work out because I really need that extra $20 or whatever. But the Lord says, no, I got your back when you do what's right. So
right.
thank
oh,
the
yeah.
Lord for his continual faithfulness.
Thank you, God.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes,
God.
Amen.
Yes, the Lord.
Yes, Pastor.
Healing for my brother David.
I'll lift him up. Yes, Mike.
Yeah, for Cindy, she's been battling this cough for 2 months now. That's enough.
Yes.
It's gone.
She's claiming the healing right now.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Yes, Mike.
I'd like for everybody to remember my mom. We moved her into assisted living. And, you know, my prayer really at this point is, Lord, just let her go to bed and let her step into the next realm, because she's just failing. She's almost 88, and you know, she's ready to go. But God love her. She's probably we have with her is all the people where she did live. She's so alienated. You know, there's witnessing, and then there's I'm going to grab you by the throat.
Yes.
So I was reading on Facebook. I read sometimes. Plus, I don't post on my very often, but I was reading, and one of my friends from church, from like elementary school, and I'm friends with him, right? Because everybody you knew once in your life. And I was just she was the one that had a baby that, you know, struggled and almost died and got healed, and it's like her 13th child. God bless her. And, but anyway, I just was scrolling one day, and the Lord said, just send her a message and tell her that I heard her prayer and give her word of encouragement. I thought, okay, I will, and I never did. And then I felt guilty. And this morning I was praying, and I was like, and then her husband got orders to send to go back to Alaska, which is where her kids are, her grandkids are, so she wanted to go. And so I don't know if it was a word of encouragement. And I'm like, well, I blew it, you know, I was meant to encourage her, but God worked it out anyway. And this morning he's like, I still want you to send her word of encouragement. The word is these people need to be encouraged, and the Lord would be putting them on my heart, and I don't know why I'm afraid to encourage somebody that may look at it. It's not me, it's the Lord, and if it's the Lord, then he will speak to their heart. So I just encourage you guys, don't be scaredy cat like I am, which is ridiculous, because yeah, I'm scaredy cat, right? I'm usually very bold, but for some reason I was holding back, and I'm like, oh, she's going to think I'm weird, I don't know whether they're spiritually, I don't know what they believe in. Speak the words of encouragement.
You can do it now from your phone. Yes, Jane. Anyone else? Okay, well, let's stand. Let's thank the Lord for this beautiful day that He has given us. Father, we thank You for gathering here in Your presence today to hear more about Your Word. Father, we thank You because You take us under You and You protect us whenever there is trouble in our lives. And we know, Lord, that You are going to deliver us from whatever it is that is oppressing us at whatever moment, whether it's sickness, whether it's disease, whether it's a financial problem, a relational situation, Lord, we know, Father, that if we trust in You, You will make everything better, Father. We thank You for all of the blessings that You have given us. We thank You for calling us Your children, Lord, for selecting us, for choosing us to go and spread Your word around this world. Wherever it is that we go, Father, we speak Your word. Things manifest in the spirit that we might not see at that moment, but we know that it's going to give fruit, whatever seed that we plant, Lord. Thank You, Father, because we know that You're the only one that can do all things, Father. Thank You, Father. We thank You, Jesus, for the sacrifice of the cross. We thank You, Lord, for giving Your only child to redeem us, to bring us back to You, to bring us closer to You, Lord. Right now, we put all of those that are in need here, those that are in need of healing, those that are in need of a financial breakthrough, those that are in need of a relation to be mended, for a provision that they're asking for. Jesus. We know, Father, that You hear all of our prayers, Lord. You hear all of our prayers, and You do everything. You give us everything, Lord, according to Your will and Your mercy, Lord, and Your goodness. Thank you. Announcements. Tom Stammen will be here this Friday, if you can make it. It's a good word. And then there's an additional announcement. It has been set a date of November 2nd for the Thanksgiving meal for the church. Yes. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll put a sign up.
Very well. So, it's going to be good. All right, let's pick the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Thank you, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper.
All
obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Thank you, Lord.
John and Toby, would you mind taking the offering? And Toby, would you say the blessing, please?
Let's worship.
Situation.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We celebrate you every day.
History split by sacrifice. God's perfect Son gave up his life to ransom back the lost and damned, paying a price that just demands. As he was broken and heaven was open, our Christ forgiven, our sons acquitted, his loving Jesus Christ, he is Lord.
It's all yours, Lord.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
It's all yours, Lord. It's all yours, Lord. Thank you. You're worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Just give him a song, church. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Oh, be glory, 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 Lord.
Remember. praise, God. We come today, Lord, to celebrate you, celebrate your faithfulness, your righteousness, your holiness, all that you've imparted to us, Lord, as a gift of your grace, of your goodness, of your love. Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless that name this morning, the name that's above every name. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise God. We thank you, Lord. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the crucifixion. Thank you, Lord, for your death, for your burial, for your resurrection, Lord. Thank you for making it ours.
Yes, Lord.
That we can share in your glory.
Yes, Lord.
Because of your perfect sacrifice, we are declared righteousness of God in you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for a perfect God, a perfect plan. Hallelujah. A perfect eternity. In Jesus' name, praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Everybody say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Good job, you guys. Thank the Lord. Praise God. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. As always, we're blessed. Praise the Lord. Amen. Sunday school kids, they can be dismissed to go downstairs. And we had a infestation of box elder bugs there on the front door of biblical proportions, praise the Lord. I opened it up, swept them down. The more I swept, the more they came out. And if you notice me scratching, I see a bug crawl on me, I didn't bring it with me. I got it right there at the front door. I've been feeling them ever since. I told Sally, you see anything on me? She just said, stupid. I don't know if anybody else is like me, but if I get around that stuff, then I just feel like I got them on me the rest of the day. Praise the Lord. Every little movement, I think, well, there comes one crawling out of my hair. Praise the Lord. Well, happy birthday, James, number 52. Praise the Lord. I'm telling you, 52 sounds pretty good right about now. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Those were the good old days. Now that's just, hallelujah, that's the truth. Praise God. I don't want to hear about your falling down and getting hurt or anything else. Just jump back up and get right back on that horse, James. If you're only 52, praise the Lord. Amen. We appreciate James. Amen. So, hallelujah. God's given him a great gift. And we appreciate him sharing that with us. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise the Lord. All right. Hallelujah. I love these songs we were singing this morning, all about Jesus, about his cross, about that perfect work of God. Yes. And that's what it is all about. Amen. Yes. Anything that distracts from that, you know, I hear people all the time calling certain groups, faith people, prosperity, and when we confess the word here and declare it, that isn't who we are. Who we are is the righteousness of God in Christ. This is just what we do. Because of that, we have that ability to expect to prosper, expect healing. Healing is not some separate or, individual kind of ministry. It's just an outgrowth of the grace of God, just like prosperity, just like protection and provision. Sally and I were talking about all this junk we're hearing now, Ebola, and if it's not that, it'll be something else. I mean, this is the newest, and of course it's the big scare, but most of us have lived long enough to have gone through multiples of this. Swine flu, it's one thing. It's bird flu, it's something else. So what we're doing is simply saying no plague will come nigh my house. I mean, that when we say no sickness, no germ, we're just declaring what God has already said about us. Amen. We're not trying to change things. We're just in agreement with it. Praise the Lord. So though 1,000 fall at my left hand and 10,000 at my right, it will not come nigh me. It's not going to harm me. It's not going to harm my family. Amen. Why? Because I'm hidden in the secret place of the Most High.
Yes.
That secret place is in Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, God.
under the wings of the Almighty. Praise the Lord. And amen. No weapon formed against me will prosper. Hallelujah. Every tongue that rises in judgment will be condemned. I'll condemn it. Amen. This is the heritage. Amen. This is the inheritance of the servants of the Lord or the children of God. Amen. And his righteousness and our righteousness is of him. Praise God. That's what the scripture says in Isaiah 54. So hallelujah. Don't let the news media or anybody else freak you out. And, you know, we're hearing all this stuff about the blood moons. I get it. I'm not against that. But come on, you can overdo anything at some point. It's most of the time, it's another way of getting more money. And, you know, I hate to say that, but it's just a fact. And anybody that's rational realizes that. We need Christian TV, and I'm all happy about it. But sometimes it's just almost embarrassing to watch it. So it's true, the blood moons and all of that, but I just, you know what? God is my protector.
That's right.
I'm not freaking out about blood moons or green moons or blue cheese moons or any other kind of moon. It's just, I understand it, I recognize it, I realize. But if it's a sign, then it's a sign to the believer to know that we're okay. We're going to be all right.
Yeah.
Amen. God's just showing us I'm still in charge here. I still got your back, praise the Lord. I will be your shield and exceed great reward. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Okay, let's get right to it this morning. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, please, Sheila. Hallelujah. And I want us to just realize, and I think we do, but it never hurts to reiterate truth. And this is all about Jesus. Anytime we deviate from that truth, that single truth, the more likely we are to get caught up in false teaching or just misunderstanding. Amen. This is about Jesus. Amen. Our life is hid in Christ. We live and move and have our being, but it's in him that we have all of that. Amen. And so Paul says, I was crucified with Christ, yet I live. But it's not I that live, but it's Christ in me. Amen. He lives. So this is all about a transfer. And it's not just as we often think, it's just he took my sins and now everything's good. He took it all. He took our sickness. He took our disease. He took our poverty. He took our ignorance. He took everything.
Yes.
And gave us him and all that he is. And now as he is, so are we in this present world. It's not going to happen someday. We're already that. We're already everything we're ever going to be. Amen. I'm talking about spiritually, we are as Christ. All we need to do is learn how to live that from the inside out. And we do that by focusing on him and not on our flesh. If God isn't focused on my flesh, why should I be? That's called sin consciousness. And it alienates you from everything that God wants to do in your life. Amen. So, wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. So, we take this scripture and many others, but we're focusing on this one this morning. Did Adam's sin affect everybody?
Yes.
Absolutely. We were all included in what he did. Even though we weren't even born yet. We are great, 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 and as many greats as you can put in there had not been born yet. Just the first grandparent, first parent, brought sin. And when Adam sinned, sin entered the world. There wasn't any sin here before that. It came when Adam sinned. In fact, there wasn't even a knowledge of sin. That's why the eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is what brought sin. Paul said, I never thought about coveting until I read the commandment, thou shalt not covet.
Right.
Bang, all of a sudden I realize I'm covetous.
Yeah.
You know? So, Adam's sin brought death. So, Death then spread to everybody, just like the sin. Amen? For everyone sinned before we ever sinned. That's why when a child is born into this world, they begin to die immediately. Any living being, death, the process of death starts at the moment of birth. Cells begin to break down, even though there's replenishing, but there's a process of dying that begins at the very instant of birth. Amen? So nobody was exempt from Adam's disobedience. We all agree with that, right? Praise the Lord. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 45. So it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. So, Jesus came into this world as the last Adam. Now, was Jesus' restoration or his restorative work sufficient to repair the damage by the first Adam? Huh? I mean, was Adam bigger than Jesus? Praise the Lord. All right, Romans chapter 5 and verse 18. So everybody was a sinner in Adam. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation. Even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification. We ought to say praise the Lord right about there. It'd be a good time. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. So Adam's sin was in no way greater than Christ's life, death, and resurrection. Amen? Yes. Praise the Lord. So the effect of Jesus Christ's work extended every bit as far as the impact of Adam's sin. In fact, he says it's where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. It overflows. Praise the Lord. Amen. So Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 4. I mean, we just need to really be radical. We just need to really be faith people. And that faith is not something that we conjure up, but it's based on the grace of God. So we can believe anything God says because of his grace concerning us, right? For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. So, okay, under that first covenant, we know that the animal sacrifices that were in the Levitical system were far less effective than the finished work of Jesus Christ. We know because the scripture said he gave us a better covenant, right? Because the blood of bulls and goats couldn't do what the perfect blood of God in flesh could do. Yeah. Praise the Lord. So, understanding that, think about this. Even though that animal blood that was offered was less efficacious, if you will, or less effective, less, you know, powerful, that blood of those animal sacrifices covered all of the sin of all of Israel. Every Israeli. Praise the Lord. So whose faith was operating when those sacrifices were offered? And if you think about this, the average Hebrew, if you will, probably had a very small understanding of the symbolism and the types and the shadows under the old covenant. Now, they knew a Messiah would come, was promised, but they didn't understand all these connections. If they did, they'd be with us right now today, right? So there's a veil, Moses said, or the scripture says that there was a veil, just like over Moses when he came down from the mountain and coming from the presence of God, that veil still exists over Israel. In general terms. So, amen? All of Israel, then, is covered by those animal sacrifices. And so whose faith was in operation there? Well, one thing is forgiveness was based on the purity of the sacrifice.
Yeah.
That's, they checked the animal, the lamb, the bullock, the goat, the whatever it was they were dealing with. That is what they investigated. And the priest who did that investigating, right, knew that the sacrifice, if that was a spotless, just undisfigured offering, he knew that it would be sufficient to cover the sins. Because he had faith in that efficacy of the blood of that animal. He was the one that made the decision. His obedience to God was sufficient to ensure Israel's sins were dealt with in full. That's why they always talk about the Israel rose and fell by the righteousness of the high priest at the time. Their protection, their provision, their blessing, and everything else, right? So it was about our high priest, faithfulness, and his confidence in God, his heavenly Father, right? That was enough to accomplish what he came to do, which was to put away our sins by the sacrifice of himself. Amen? Now, I'm just simplifying, really, what religion has complicated for 2,000 years. And that's what, you know, the Bible says not, I'm afraid Paul said that you've erred from the simplicity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You've made all these rules and all this stuff, and you've compounded and confounded people because you have gone away from the fact that this is just about Jesus, period. Everything and every and anything that's in this Bible is pointing to him, is talking about him, amen, is trying to reveal us to him, praise the Lord, or him to us, I should say. So, look at Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 26. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. He's a better, obviously the perfect sacrifice. He doesn't have to keep coming back like they did every year on the Day of Atonement for Israel. That one sacrifice was sufficient for everybody forever.
Amen.
Prior to, then, and forever after. Praise the Lord. So the core issue of the finished work of Jesus Christ isn't our faith. Hallelujah. It's his faithfulness. See, when Jesus said he came to set us free, he meant it. Religion make it all about your faith, your effort, your work, your righteousness, your holiness, your whatever. But I'm telling you, this has, it's not about our faith. It's about his faithfulness. That takes all of the onus off of us. All of the responsibility has already been met. Amen? I'm just go a step further. I'm not saying, I'm not into universalism. I'm not saying everybody's going to heaven. But I'm saying just as that animal sacrifice was sufficient based on the high priest's understanding of faithfulness of God to his word, every Jew was covered for an entire year. Every human being has been covered by the blood of Jesus. Now, I'm not saying everybody's saved, but I'm saying that sacrifice was sufficient to cover every human being that's ever lived or that ever will live. So there's nobody outside of our high priest's faithfulness to God. Hallelujah. That's good news. Amen. It's good news to us who may know people that are not saved, who are not believers. Amen. Because the only, all they got to do is say. Just got to say it. And I'll take it even further. How many times do we know little kids, do they understand? I mean, do they really get it? But yet they, there's something that they just say, yes, I accept Jesus as my Savior, or, you know?
Yeah.
And God honors that.
Yes.
Why? Because everything's been done. The kid doesn't need to do anything except acknowledge.
Yes, right.
Praise the Lord. So, you know, here's religion emphasizes our decisions. The good news of the gospel is it's all about his decision. He decided to come. He decided to go through with this plan, even though everything in his flesh was fighting against it. You know, sweating drops of blood, you know, in anguish. My God, you know, if there's some way I can, you know, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Amen. So our faith is simply, well, the gospel talks about Abraham rejoiced to see his day, and Jesus said he did. So our faith is simply a joyous or joyful response to what he has already done successfully for us. Praise the Lord. Because I want to show you this morning, Abraham wasn't just believing for a son. He was believing that his son might be the Messiah. And if not his son, then maybe his son's son. And if not him, then maybe his son's son's son. If not him, maybe a great-great-great-grandson. But somewhere, through this lineage, the entire world is going to get blessed. Somehow, through him was going to come the Messiah. That's what God preached to him. If that's not true, then Jesus was lying in the New Testament. And we'll get to those scriptures in a minute. But you say, well, we have to have faith to be justified, don't you? I mean, that's what we're taught. But let's look at Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So there's no argument. We have to agree. But whose faith causes us to be justified? Right? We preach that you're justified by faith, and we assume then, based on everything else that the church has basically taught, is that it must be my faith. I got to have that faith in order to be justified by what Jesus did. Amen? So, I mean, it's true that faith is the conduit or the means through which justification comes. But it's Jesus' faith that has justified us. Praise the Lord. He isn't waiting for us to do something, amen, so that we can be justified through some act of our own. It would be totally contrary to everything else that the Gospels teach. Praise the Lord. It's not our faith. Amen. Let's look at two simple words. And they are the crux or the, you know, they're what is so relative to justification. And those words are in and of. Just two-letter words. In and of. And so we look at those two words relative to justification. To be justified by faith in Christ, right? Listen to the way I'm saying it. To be justified by faith in Christ is very different from being justified by the faith of Christ. Right? One depends on my faith, and the other depends or rests in his faith. All right, look at Romans chapter 3 and verse 22. I mean, this gospel of grace gets better and better and better. I mean, it's perfect, but I mean, for us, as we understand, it just gets better. It just gets better and better, praise the Lord. Even the righteousness of God, which is by the faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. Right? Praise the Lord. Look at Galatians chapter 2, verse 16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Galatians 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I don't know about anybody else, but I've got goosebumps right now. Praise the Lord. See, the first and the most important principle whenever we try to interpret the Bible or understand the Scripture is that there's only two ways to look at it. It's either, as the Greeks would say, Christocentric, which is Christ-centered, or else it's egocentric, meaning self-centered.
Yeah.
So whenever you look at the Bible, whenever you're reading the Bible and trying to understand the Bible, if you're reading it from the way religion has basically taught it, it's egocentric. It's all about what you're doing or what you aren't doing or what you should do or what you have to do. When in fact, that's approaching it from the wrong perspective to begin with, so everything's going to be flawed as a result of that. But you won't ever be mistaken if you always approach it from a Christ-centered perspective. It's about Jesus. It's about what he's done. It's about his finished work. It's about the accomplishment, amen, of God in the flesh. So let's just continue to look here at the distinction between the in and the of, right? Romans chapter 3, verses 25 and 26. Whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood. Now that word propitiation actually translates elasterion is the Greek word, but it's the same word that they use for mercy seat. So whom God has set forth, Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a mercy seat through faith in his blood. The blood gets sprinkled on the mercy seat under the old covenant. That's the way the Day of Atonement took place. To declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believe in Jesus. So we're not justified by our faith. He's the justifier. And I know we see this which believeth, and that's always what we get hung up on, and I'll get to it in a minute, but let's not focus on us, okay? Right? We're supposed to be focused on him. And then it'll make sense to us, where in the past it looks like a contradiction almost, yeah, based on what I'm saying today, right? So faith in Jesus, verse 26, to declare, I say at this time, righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which faiths in Jesus. Okay? So the first text refers to faith in Jesus. Now let's go, let me look at this. Let's compare that with Romans chapter 4 and verse 16. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promises might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Now, the first text we read from Romans chapter 3 refers to the faith in Jesus, or believe in Jesus, right? At the end, verse 26. But then the second speaks of the faith of Abraham, right? One verse uses, now see, it's the same, we're saying the same thing, the faith of Abraham or our faith in Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? So one verse uses the word in, and the other chooses the word of. But they're saying the same thing.
Yes.
Right? Abraham's, the faith of Abraham, or us believing in Jesus. All right? But look, let's look at, let me just show you something. I referred to it at the very beginning. Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6. Now, Abraham's received a promise from God, and he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. Now, he's told him that he's going to be blessed, and he's going to be a blessing, that his seed will, you know, cover the earth like the water covers the sea, or the sand and the stars cover the sky, and so forth. But then he also says that through you, all nations will be blessed. Now, we have generally thought, and I'll just speak for myself, generally thought that he was just concerned about the son, Isaac. How am I going to know that this is true? Right? And God tells him, I'm going to give you a son. And he changes his name, and they do the whole thing with the walking down through the sacrificed animals and the smoking light and the lamp and so forth. Well, Abraham believed in God's redemptive plan.
Yes.
Right? Abraham offered up Isaac. Abraham understood. Now, we think he didn't know. He was just dealing with the things that were going on there. No. The gospel was preached to Abraham. This gospel of grace was preached to Abraham. Amen. Look at Galatians chapter 3. Verses 5 through 9. He therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. All right. Not in a son, but in the son, was the message that God preached to Abraham. Now, obviously, he had to have a son in order for there to be a the son. But this was all about redemption. And Abraham knew that, and if he didn't know it, he learned it quick, amen, on the mountain when he offered Isaac, or was willing to offer Isaac, and a substitute ram appears, amen, to take the place of his son. The gospel was preached to Abraham, the same gospel that we're talking about today. Not a different one, not a miniature one, not a less defined one, but the very same gospel. That the grace of God was going to substitute, amen, for all of man. Praise the Lord. Now, okay, look at John chapter 8 and verse 56. And this refers to the scripture that we talked about earlier where Jesus was speaking to these Jews. And they didn't get any of this. But this is exactly what Jesus was talking about. He said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day and saw it and was glad. He saw the plan of God come about. Amen. How he saw it, I don't know. But God showed it to him. He revealed it to him through word pictures. I don't know how it was done. But Abraham saw, amen, by faith in the Spirit, he saw the Messiah come and deliver the world from their sin. And he was glad. Praise the Lord. Amen. Jesus, in other words, is the object of our faith. Praise the Lord. Now, because of that, well, let's look at this Romans chapter 3 and verse 26. And I'll show you what I mean. It sounds like I'm arguing with myself here. But verse 26 says, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Amen. And then, let me think. Romans 4, verse 16. Therefore, it is of faith, that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who's the father of us all, right? So, they use the same words with the exception of the names, Jesus and Abraham. Right? You understand what I'm saying here? Or did I confuse you by jumping around? So here's the question. Is it his faith or our faith that matters? The answer is yes. Now, see, his faith becomes our faith. Look at how Paul explains it in Galatians chapter 3, verse 22. But the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. Amen? So the faith of Jesus Christ has taken away our sin, has reconciled us to the Father, has given us forgiveness, and has made us righteous, has healed us, has delivered us, has prospered us, has set us free. Amen? Those benefits of the cross are, and I talked about this, I don't know if it was last Sunday or Wednesday a while back, but those benefits of the cross are objectively factual. They are objectively true. They are physical things that actually happened, right? Because of Jesus. Now, when he said, it is finished, he meant it. He meant, it's finished. Praise the Lord. So, Galatians chapter 3, verse 22 again, Paul says to them that believe, but the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. That is, believers' subjective actual experience. You have an objective, which is the material, the natural. Then you have the subjective, which is mental or ethereal, or it's not a physical thing. It's something you receive through your spirit, we'll say, and it becomes a reality. It's a tangible, real thing, just like your healing is. But you have to receive it. I mean, you understand what I'm saying? Faith, that's the way this whole thing works, amen? That is the believer's subjective, actual experience. Now, I'm talking pure grace here. You see, it's necessary for us to believe that we are in right standing with God because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. We believe it because Jesus has already accomplished it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We believe it in order to experience it. Praise the Lord. Our faith is the activation of his faith. Our faith is the activation of his faith in and through us. Praise God. There aren't two faiths. There isn't my faith and his faith. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 and 5. There is only one body, one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. Praise the Lord. One faith. not a whole bunch of different people's faith. It's just his faith. Period. Amen. Glory to God. Romans chapter 1 and verse 17. And we'll wrap up right after this. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Right? The faith of Jesus becomes our faith. Paul, in writing here in Romans, is referring to a scripture from the Old Testament, from Habakkuk chapter 2. And we'll close with this one. Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. It's not from one faith to another faith that he's being revealed. Understand? I will stand upon my watch, set me upon the tower. This is a prophetic sight or vision that Habakkuk has of the Messiah, of Jesus. And I'll watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. We know that there was a specific time that God had in mind to be born into this world. The fullness of time, he calls it. So there was an appointed time or a fullness of time. But at the end of it, shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. It's not talking about my faith. It's talking about the person that he's having this vision of. The just shall live by his faith. Not our faith, his faith, because there's only one faith. Amen? So here's the synopsis of the whole thing. When we believe, we begin to live out in time what has been settled in eternity. Now, we call it faith. We call it our faith. But it's his faith that has been given to us, amen, by simply agreeing or believing. His faith grows in us. That's why how does our faith grow? Well, if you want to use those kind of terms, how does my faith grow? My faith doesn't grow. His faith is sufficient. His faith is more than enough for anything and everything. I only need, like he told the disciples, you're getting this wrong. You need faith the size of a mustard seed. In other words, your faith is irrelevant here.
Yes.
You just have to believe in what my faith.
Yes.
And then you receive it. It's just like the mind of Christ. You got to believe that you have received the mind of Christ in order to ever walk out that reality.
Yes.
Right? It's all been done. It's all been done. Objectively, Jesus did it all. But subjectively, we simply walk it out. We walk out and we do it by believing the reality of the objective act. The physical thing that he did. The beating that he took for the stripes that he received for our healing. You understand what I'm saying? I don't have to have faith. I don't need to have faith to believe that Andrew Jackson was a president of the United States. I never saw the man. I never talked to anybody that ever saw the man. I've only read some books that said other people lived here when he was president. I just believe it. I don't need faith to believe in a historic record of an action that had already taken place. I just believe it. God said it. I believe it. Amen. That's what this is all about. You can quit worrying about trying to conjure up great faith. You have all the faith of God, the faith that brought this whole thing into existence, that spoke worlds, that said light be. Amen. And there it is. And all you got to do is walk in that reality of what he has done. That's the good news of the gospel. That's what Abraham believed. He just believed God. He didn't have great faith. He just believe God. And so now we have the faith of Abraham. Well, it wasn't Abraham's faith in the first place. He just believed God. And God counted it to him as righteousness.
Yes.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. That's why he can tell us without any equivocation, whatsoever you believe, you can have it.
Yes.
Nothing shall be impossible to them that believe.
Yes.
Amen. And we're thinking, oh, I believe, but help my unbelief. Come on, man. Either you believe it or you don't believe it. And if you believe it, you have all the faith of God backing you up. Your healing is assured.
Yes.
Your loved ones are saved.
Yes.
Hey, it's not, they don't have to have great faith. They just got to believe.
Yes.
Just believe that he did it. Just read the book and believe it.
Yes.
Think about it. The reason atheists are atheists, which I think is a misnomer. I don't think it's even ought to be a real word. They're just stupid. Because
yeah.
They don't believe a historic record. And we have more evidence of it today than we've ever had in the last 2,000 years. Every time you turn on the History Channel, you'll find, you know, they may be trying to tell you they're ancient aliens, but they're still giving us factual, physical, objective proofs of the existence of Jesus and all that he's done. Amen. It's finished. It is finished. And he finished it so perfectly that our human nature to want to, you know, the scripture says the cross offends. We say, how can you be offended by the cross? Because human nature wants to take some of the responsibility, wants to have something, and it's offensive. I mean, if you don't believe me, just go talk to some Pentecostal, or doesn't have to be Pentecostal, could be anybody, that they've got nothing to do with this. Except believing. And I guarantee you, you'll find out in a hurry, the cross can offend. When it's presented in the truth. When it's presented in the true light of what Jesus has done. It's finished. That doesn't make them bad people. It just means them uninformed people. Praise the Lord. This thing sets people free. And first and foremost, it ought to set us free. As believers, hallelujah. To live our lives, amen, from faith. To faith, as his faith is given to us as our faith. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Have a great week. Amen. Be free. Stay free. Enjoy this gift of salvation. Hallelujah. See you back here next week. God bless.